You're talking to God, your Father. Love on Jesus. Love on your Master. He has done so much. He has loved us so much. He has given us so much. In a trillion years, we can never pay him back. Father, we love you. Father, we honor you. We thank you. We love you, Lord. We are very grateful. We really, really appreciate you, Lord. From the depths of our heart, from the depths of our soul, from our innermost being, we say thank you. From our innermost being, we love you, Lord. We worship your holy name, not just with songs, Lord, but with our lives and everything that we do, Lord. Teach us on a daily to love you more, Lord. Teach us on a daily to please you more, Lord. Thank you. Thank you. You've been a good Father. You've been a great and loving Father. Thank you for this retreat and the change and transformation that is occurring in the lives of the men and women that are gathered at this retreat. Thank you, Lord. Holy Spirit, it is a big deal that you are here with us. You live inside of us, but you're also here. It is a big deal. It is not light, Lord. It is not light. Thank you for coming. Thank you, Holy Spirit. I ask that you have your way. We give you unrestrained access into every life. And even in this place, we're asking for your manifest presence throughout the day. Thank you. Thank you. Write upon the tables of our hearts in deep letters, Lord. Such a way that we'll be guided by them and will not forget them, Lord. Thank you. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. What you have on your inside is richer than the gold mines on planet Earth. His name is the Spirit of the Living God. You know that song? Something more than gold. Something more than gold. The Spirit of God in the hearts of men is something more than gold. Something more than gold.
Something more than gold. Something more than gold. The Spirit of God in the hearts of men is something more than gold.
One more time, let's sing that song.
Something more than gold.
Something more than gold.
Something more than gold.
Something more than gold.
Something more than gold. Something more than gold. The Spirit of the Lord in the hearts of men is something more than gold.
Do you have something more than gold?
Something more than gold.
Something more than gold.
Something more than gold. The Spirit of the Lord in the hearts of men is something more than gold.
Hallelujah. It is lack of understanding that you have something more than gold. That is why Christians sell themselves cheap. That is why they compromise. That is why they give up fellowship, give up reading the Bible, give up prayer, give up the service of the Lord for the service of men. People exchange gold for stone and they think they are doing well. It's because we don't understand that what we have is more than gold. When the Spirit of a man of God resides in a man, that man is the richest entity on planet Earth and beyond. We are called the masters of creation. We are co-creators with God. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Good morning to everyone. God bless you. Thank you again, Pastor Fred. God bless you. Want you to know that we love you. We honor you. We appreciate all your investments in our lives and destiny. Do I speak for everyone here? All right. Appreciate God for the gifts. Amen. Hallelujah. He says, give honor to whom what? Honor is due. The Bible says to us in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11, he said, he gave gifts to the church. One of the gifts is what? He said, apostles, prophets, and God gave us a pastor. He said, he gave some. He said, and God has given us a pastor and a teacher. And because of that ministry, our lives are changing. Hallelujah. Along with all the men of God that walk with him, that partner with him, that have God has used as instruments to be a blessing to each and every one of us. God bless you and bless you and bless you. Whatever blessing God gives you here in time is just mobilization fee. Your main reward is waiting for you where? in heaven on the other side. So you have to do your best to get there so that you can partake of your reward. Hallelujah. So today's short session, very quickly, my assignment today is simple. I'm going to be answering 7 vital questions. Those questions are very vital. I'll call them the scorecard, God's scorecard for men. God's scorecard for men. You know how it is called? You have a scorecard. In every organization, you have a scorecard. There's what in HR, there's something we call balanced scorecard. But anyway, you have the scorecard for men, God's scorecard for men. These questions are very vital, especially because of Ephesians chapter 5, verse 10. If you are not intentional about your walk with the Lord, you miss out on this. If you look at it, especially from the NLT version of the Bible, it says carefully. In other words, be intentional to determine what pleases the Lord. That means it is not everything that pleases the Lord. And that means the things that please the Lord are not obvious. That's why he said, carefully determine. If you don't carefully determine what pleases the Lord, what will happen to you is that you are going to live your life doing many things that do not impress God. Because not everything impresses God. And not everything counts. There are many good things we do that do not count. There are many areas in our lives where we exert a lot of effort, spend a lot of money, spend a lot of time, and invest our thought process and all of that inside it, but those things do not please God. So what a wise person should do is Ephesians 5:10. He says, sit down, carefully determine what are the things that please the Lord. When you get a job in an organization and you're a smart person, one of the things you want to do is to find out what are the key performance indicators in that organization. What it means, and what are the things they reward in this organization? When I used to work as a GM in a company, my boss would always say that, I don't care if you come to work Monday to Sunday. I really don't care. What I'm interested in is revenue generation. So he would tell the staff, if they come in Monday to Monday and they're not generating revenue, it doesn't impress me. One. Secondly, he would tell you that effort is not good enough. I don't care about your effort. I just want results. So I'm not interested in, oh, I visited 10,000 clients. The results. So he has told us verbally and in writing, what are the key performance indicators? So essentially what he means is, if you come to work, that's fine. If you don't come, that's fine. At the end of the day, is the bottom line he's looking at. For some other organizations, for instance, in school, they will tell you, you have to have 75% attendance. That attendance will make up your final grade. So when you go to school, or when you work in an organization, or even you're in a relationship, you want to know, what are the key performance indicators? In other words, what are the things that matter? What are the things that count? So to God, he has told us very clearly in the Bible that he doesn't think or see like man sees. He says his ways are not our ways. His thoughts are higher than our thoughts. He spoke to us in 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 7. He said, man, God does not see the way man sees. So that means if you're dealing with God, you have to be careful not to deal with God like you're dealing with men. Because you might be evaluating the things you are doing based on the way men would evaluate the things. But God has a different set of evaluation system. So a smart person that wants the favor of God, that wants to please the Lord, will sit down and say, okay, now of all of these things I'm doing, what are the things that carry the highest weight? You want to go into school and then you want to study medicine and then your best course is poetry, literature, and food and nutrition. Are you going to pass? No. Simply because you don't know the things that count. If you're going to write JAMB, YEG, there are 9 subjects in YEG. A wise person knows that the university needs 5 courses for you to enter. You have to have 5 courses. So what you should do is concentrate on your 5 major courses. But some foolish people will go and then concentrate on the minors, the things that are not really important. They spend all their time reading literature. This is a science student. He's reading literature. Meanwhile, he has forgotten that literature is an elective. He passes literature, the university doesn't care. He fails, they don't care. What they are looking at for a science student is what? Maths, English, physics, chemistry, biology. You know that if you clear all A's in this one, well, even if you have F9 in the other one, they don't care. So that's how we function when we go to school. And it's the same way we should function with the Lord. So Ephesians 5:10 says, be careful. Find out what are the things that please the Lord. If you don't know what they are, you might be among the people that say, I've been serving God for the past 15 years, nothing to show for it. Well, that's because you've been serving God in your way. You've chosen the things that matter to you, but they are not things that matter to God. Then you find somebody who has only served the Lord for 2 years, but that person has understood the things that the Lord cares for. And he concentrates in those 2 years on those things. You see that when both of you are weighed, this one that has known God for 2 years has more weight before God than you. Because this one sat down to say, okay, let's do this. Let's be wise in our walk with God. What are the things that matter to God? So I'm going to look at the scorecard, just 7 points. Number one, remember, all of these questions I'm asking, I'm going to ask all, but I'm not going to be able to answer all. I'll just pick one or two or three or whatever, and then we'll be done. Number one, how does God measure failure in the life of a man? By man, I mean male man, not just man generally. How does God measure, not success now, but failure? What is it that God will see and say, this man failed as a man, as a male? Not what men say. There are many people that the world has written off and said they failed. Question, did God sanction that failure? How does God evaluate failure in the life of a man? Because there are many failed men according to God. And there are also many failed men according to men. But guess whose judgment counts? It's God. Because at the end of the day, the person judging you, the person marking your report card, the person that weigh you in the balance, according to Daniel chapter 5, 24, the man, the king Belshazzar, was weighed in the balance. The Bible says he was found wanting. The person that's going to weigh you at the end of the day is not man. The person that weigh you is God. So you want to find out from God, what is it that God sees? And God says, these people have failed. Remember in Revelation chapter 2, he was talking to us about the church, and he said, Jesus was writing to the church in Smyrna. He said, look, you guys, I know what you think. In your own words, you think you have failed, but I'm telling you that you are rich. You think you are poor, I'm telling you that you are rich. So number one, how does God measure failure in the life of a man? Number two, how does God measure failure in the life of a Christian? Beyond just being a man, you are also a Christian, and the criteria are different. What is it that God will see and you say, this person failed not just as a man, but he failed as a Christian. They are failed Christians. All this I'm saying, God's perspective. Number three, how does God measure failure in the life of a husband? Not just that you are a Christian, not just that you are a man. How does God measure failure in the life of a husband? Because at the end of the day, you are either currently a husband or you are going to be at some point. So if you're single, this is beneficial to you because you at least know what to begin to build up so that you don't fail as a husband. If you're already a husband, maybe you already failed, and then this will be able to help you know the things that matter. And remember, I'm not talking from your wife's perspective. I'm talking from God's perspective now. I'm not talking from what social media or all these people are showing you are the criteria for failure and success. I'm telling you God's perspective. Then number four, how does God measure failure, evaluate failure in the life of a father? There's a young man I know, he's always complaining his father failed them, his father failed them. And I asked him, what exactly did your father do? His father didn't provide money, his father is sick and all of that. Is that how God evaluates failure on the part of a father? Number five, how does God measure failure in a Christian professional? You have a job, you're the CEO, you're the marketing manager, you are the cleaner, you are the receptionist, you have a job, you have a business. If you go to Forbes, they'll write Forbes list of the most successful organizations. That is men when they're evaluating. But when God is evaluating you as a professional, you as a doctor, you as a minister, you as whatever it is you are doing, God evaluates by a different set of standards. Your company might be doing well. The bottom line, you know, there's something they call double bottom line. If you study economics, even HR, I think they touch a bit of that there. There's double bottom line. There are organizations that the first bottom line is money, how much money they are bringing in. But then there's what is called the second bottom line. And they are looking at societal impact. How is that organization impacting the society? Look at the Niger Delta region. These are all companies, big companies. But guess what? They are doing well in the bottom line in terms of money, naira, kobo, dollars, pound. But they failed woefully in the second bottom line. Look at the damage and the degradation in the Niger Delta because of oil spillage. And they are not doing anything about it. So God has a bottom line. You that you are a doctor or you own a company, whatever, you are rating yourself, oh, we are doing well because our bottom line, every month we make X amount of money in terms of revenue. Every month we are hitting the bar in terms of this, in terms of that. Forms has recognized us. This organization has recognized us. Yes, all well and good. But how does God measure success and failure of an organization? How do you know that to God the organization failed? How do you know that to God the organization succeeded? As a Christian professional, that business you are doing. Number six, how does God measure failure or success of a marriage? Is your marriage succeeding? Is it failing? How do I know? God's perspective. Then number seven, how does God measure the success of a minister of God? Because essentially all of us will start as human beings and then we graduate to become Christians. And then God expects every single one of us to become a minister. A minister is not that you're preaching on the pulpit. A minister is that one that is carrying out the assignment of the Lord. So what is God's criteria? We saw in Matthew 7, 21, 22 and 23, basically 21 and 22, this group of ministers who had served the Lord, in their opinion, they did excellently well. But then Jesus comes to them and he gives them a damning report. Their scorecard was very bad. He said, not everyone who calls me Lord, Lord will enter the kingdom of heaven. Only those who actually do the will of my Father in heaven, they will be the ones to enter. And then he says, on judgment day, that is the day you'll be weighed in the balance, many will say to me, meaning what? Majority are going to fail the tests. Because he said, majority will say to me, Lord, Lord, meaning they were Christians, they recognized the lordship of the Lord verbally. He said, we prophesied. In other words, they carried out the ministry. We cast out demons in your name. They were not fake pastors. They were not using the power of darkness. We performed many miracles in your name. And then in verse 23, Jesus gives them the verdict and he says, but I, Jesus, will reply, I never knew you. Get away from you, you who break God's law. You see that the scorecard these people gave themselves, they passed the exams. Like Pastor Otello said, will you mark the exam for you? Set the exam for yourself. You mark the exam for yourself. But you're not the ultimate judge. The Bible says every man is right in his own eyes. Let me tell you, a psychologist will tell you, right? Your brain is designed to think you are right all the time. That's how your brain is designed to think. Your brain tells you. So in a conversation with someone, your brain remembers only the part of the conversation that favors you. That's how your brain functions. Again, your brain is functioned to help you preserve your brain cells. I don't want to go into all of those details, but I'll tell you. Your brain is designed, modulated to see only the good you are doing. That's why you can't, it's difficult for you to cut your tongue. There are many things you can't do. You can't tickle yourself, no matter how hard you try. Another person will tickle you and you will laugh. You can't tickle yourself. There are some things you can't do. You have to overwrite a lot of programs in your brain to do a lot of things. So that's why we want to look at God's perspective. Let me show you how serious this is. Let me even pick the one for marriage and run through that very quickly. How does God determine a failed marriage? You know why? There are many marriages that they've not divorced at all. They are still together. They haven't even broken up at all. But in the sight of God, when God weighs that marriage is a failed project, though they've not divorced. They are living together. But that marriage has failed. So when God evaluates that marriage, in his eyes, the marriage failed. So let's take a look at Genesis chapter 2, running from the beginning. Let's see God's intention for marriage in the first place. That you're not divorced does not mean that your marriage is successful. That you've not broken up does not mean your marriage is successful. We have to look at God's system, 23 of Genesis chapter 2. So this is God talking. And then he says, at last the man exclaimed. This is after God had brought Eve up. He said, at last, this one is bone from my bone and flesh from my flesh. She will be called woman because she was taken from man. Verse 24. This explains, King James will tell you, will say, for this reason. But this one says, this explains why a man will leave his father and mother and is joined to his wife, and the two are united into one. King James will tell you, and the two becomes one flesh. Here he's telling you how to measure marriage. Now, it didn't just end in Genesis. He pulled it all the way to the Gospels, because it's recorded everywhere. If you take a look at Mark chapter 10, this was reiterated. If you pick it from verse 6 to 8, it was reiterated, the exact same thing. He said, but God made them male and female, beginning from creation. We'll look at 6 to 8. Let's look at verse 7. This explains why a man leaves his father and mother and is joined to his wife. And the two are united into one. I explained this shortly. Since they are no longer two, but one. And it didn't just end in the gospel. Because someone will come and say, oh, this is the gospel. You know, Jesus hadn't yet died. So they are not talking to new creation people. Well, let's run to Ephesians chapter 5, verse 31. If you go through the scripture, you'll find it in the Pentateuch. That is the first five books. You find it in the Songs. You find it in the Kings. You find it in the Judges. You find it in the Gospels. You find it in the Epistles. You still find it in Revelation. It is a recurring trend. So again, they repeat the same thing. This is Paul now writing the Epistles. And the scripture says, a man leaves his father and mother and is joined to his wife, and the two are united into one. Here, it gives us some of the clues to know whether you're married. Number one, have you actually left your roots? What kind of influence is your roots having on your marriage? You've not divorced, though, but your mother stays where she is and she's determining what happens. Your father, your brother, your uncle, your sister, they stay where they are, and their influence is impacting on what you are doing in that marriage. It's failed. See the plan. God said that this man, and the man is the one that is the one that will take is the initiator. The man will leave the father, leave the mother. He's the one to do the proposal. It's not these days. Women will be the one to do this particular one. And then, how was the foundation of that marriage? Did the man actually leave did he leave one? And then, the woman, was she giving in marriage? So, some marriages are failed from foundation level. And number two, and to be joined to the wife. Spiritual unity. So, how you rate the success of a marriage is how much unity do you people have? If there is no spiritual unity, you may not have divorced, but in the sight of God, in the evaluation plan of God, in the scorecard of God, that marriage is a failed project because there is no unity. And there is even no plan towards unity. So, there is spiritual unity. You must become one. There's emotional unity. There's unity across, but it doesn't matter if it is a Spanish man that married a Yoruba girl. There must be that unity. There's Yoruba culture, but there's a culture of both of them fused into one. So you evaluate yourself. How united am I to and with my spouse? Is there a bond? Is there emotional unity? There are people that are committing emotional adultery. You are living with Mr. A, but in your mind, your emotions are for somebody else. Your heart is for someone else. Now, because you are a Christian, you haven't committed the act, but your emotions are invested in something else. So already, that's a failed marriage. So if you, number one, do not disconnect from your roots, the amount of influence your father and mother are having on you, your brothers and sisters, your brother will come and dictate what will happen. That's why I'm very appreciative of my husband. Early, he warned his family. You see, this is my marriage. It is a no-go area. You see, this is my wife. It is a no-go area for you people. It's a no-go area. And that is what every man should do. You make sure this happens. If not, it's a failed project. Let me show you another thing that, how many have I given you? Living, making sure the foundation is okay and all of that. Number one. Number two, the root. You've disconnected from your root. That you're scoring yourself, right? And then you also take a look at what sort of unity do we have? And you'll be honest to yourself and with yourself. And then, let me show you another one. The third one, Malachi chapter 2, verse 15. This is how you check the quality of your marriage. Didn't the Lord make you one with your wife in body and spirit? You are his. And what does he want? Godly children from your union. So guard your heart.
That's why I was telling you that some people are emotionally connected to other people. They go to their organization, they are connected to their bosses. They come to church, they are emotionally invested in their pastor. There are many women who serve their pastors more than they serve their husbands. When they come to serve, example, maybe if he's here, when they come to serve as a friend, you see them, they'll be standing, they'll almost faint, they'll be kneeling down, they'll be paying attention to his every need. They know his needs. But my own question normally is, do you know the needs of your husband? Do you serve him like this? Some people, the kind of honor they give to their boss doesn't have part two, but they can't transfer that same honor to their husband in the house. So he said, guard your heart. You give him honor. Anything your boss says is what you are going to do. But when your husband talks, because of you've seen him finish, you know him, you take him for granted. And you take her for granted. Then he now says, remain what? Loyal to what? The wife of your youth. So what's he telling us here? You see another way God checks union. He sees the product. If you don't give God godly children, you may not be divorced, but it's a failed project. You are doubling the work the pastor has to do. You are the first pastor of your home, man. Woman, you are the first pastress of your home. You have no business. It is an error for you to come and lead the church. And I'm not the one saying it. It's in the Bible. If you can't take care of your home, what business do you have taking care of the church of God? So if you cannot produce godly union, the Bible says this is the reason I brought the two of you together, to produce godly children. I saw one man of God, and he was saying things are utterly untrue. He said, and I'll show you from the scripture, in the same Ephesians chapter 5. He said, listen, you know, you people don't understand men of God. That men of God, they'll travel everywhere. They'll come back. They'll be tired. They will not have the time to invest in their children. That is why God put the woman to take care of the children. Is that what God said? Can we even take a look at the Bible? I think it's verse 23, where he said, do not provoke your children. Ephesians chapter 5. He said, do not provoke your children. He was talking to men. He said, Father, do not provoke your children. Look at, I think it's, let's see if it's 21. He started by saying, do not provoke your children unto wrath. He said, but rather bring them up in the admonition of the... He said, and you fathers, who is he talking to here? Fathers. Because when I get to failure of fathers, you see that. He said, and you fathers, he's talking to men, no? Fathers. He said, provoke not your children to wrath, but do what? Bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. Question, who is to bring up the children? Fathers. But what do we have bringing up children today? Mothers. So what you are doing is you are sending a signal to your children, especially to your sons, that church is for women. So they grow up thinking that church is a women thing. That men are not solid spiritual people. You see the women praying. You see them fasting. You see them praying over their children. You see them giving. Go to the villages. Every money a mother has, she say, ah, she'll go. She'll say, ah, pastor, priest, this one is for my son. Please let me pray for his success. Ah. Is the mothers that buy Bibles for their children. But look at what God said. So the man said, you people don't understand men of God, that they travel everywhere. They will come back. They'll be so tired. They will not have time. That is a sacrifice. I say you are doing sacrifice to yourself. He said it's a sacrifice. He said we are sacrificing our family for the advancement of the kingdom. You are a failed man. No, you are a failed minister. You don't know anything. Oh, the people you are going to win, are they not children? Are they not souls? Your own children, are they not souls? So the way God planned it is that the home is the first church. But what's happening to, because we have men who are failed as husbands, right? You now transfer the responsibility to the pastor. Many of the things we are teaching you should be basic home training. One day, somebody in this church came to my house. This is a lady. She was sitting in the car. I think one of my daughters was supposed to drive her to a program. I came out of the house. The lady saw me. She was sitting in the car. She saw me. I know she saw me. She saw me because I stand. How big is my house? She was outside. She was sitting in the car. I came out. I was now talking to my daughter. My daughter was already in driver's seat. So my daughter came out, meaning that both of them heard me, finished talking with me, got back in the car. That lady sat in that car. Finished. And the car drove her. It didn't occur to her that this person is older than me. This person is the mother of this, my friend. It didn't even occur to her. Come on, even in that side, don't even come on. Just as you're sitting in that car, just say, good afternoon, ma. Just kept quiet, sat down there, oblivious, didn't care. That thing, they don't even teach you in church. It's home training, it's lack of home training. So what's going on is many people don't have basic home training. So they now come to church and that you now turn the church to your house. No. These are many little things that they teach you at home. We are teaching grooming. Who should have taught you grooming? Your father and your mother. You look at how your father wakes up in the morning. He makes his bed. He brushes his teeth. He combs his hair. You, the father, the husband, you are scattered at home. Then you want your children to be well groomed. No. So this is how God checks. He checks the children. If your children are wild, that marriage is failed. I see a lot of small children running wild at their tender age. They're already wild. You can't quite see them. You can't control them. They are wild. That father, that mother, that marriage is already a failed project. And I already see as that person is wild, he's going to grow up wild. We are not in America where they say don't cane children. Bring your, if you like, don't bring cane. Don't buy Koboko. Koboko resets your brain to factory fitting. I was in a car with one woman in America. Hey, Father in heaven. Her son was throwing a tantrum. He was stretching. She said she wanted to go somewhere and she needed her phone to be able to do Google, whatever, Google Map. She said, no, I don't want to give him my phone. I'm playing a game. I said, hey, Father in heaven. She was now begging each other, please, we need the phone. We need to get the address of where we're going to. Please, oh God. In my mind, I had projected in my body, I slapped the boy's head many times. She now said, please, the boy started stretching at the back seat of the car. Oh Lord. So at some point, the mother now went in to go and do something. I turned. I said, listen, I am not your mother. I will slap you. Better give me that phone now. Quick. You know, give me the phone. I said, hey, when the mother came, I said, take. I said, why can't you cane him? He said, you know, in America, we're not supposed to cane our children. It's called child abuse. I said, but this boy is wild. He will slap. There are demons that come out by slap. Just give them one slap. Slap is fine. You know, in African home, they all say, oh, your mother need. They just look at you. You go to your uncle's house. They say, will you eat? Your mother will say, eat now. Eat. Don't worry. Ah, can I show you at the end? Yeah, eat. Your mother will just look at you. She has told you the whole. If you like, eat that food. Your destiny is hanging. Better go and start borrowing a fairly used destiny. Because your destiny is gone. And she'll be the one telling you, eat. It doesn't matter. You only eat. Ah, eat. You don't want to eat. Eat, oh. Then when the auntie gets up, she'll now look at you like. She has told you. You now say, auntie, don't worry. Are you not hungry? No, auntie, I'm not hungry. You say, can I? You sure? Say, no, auntie, I'm not hungry. I'm okay. I'm full. Then when she told her mother, say, you would have eaten, I would have twisted your mouth. That's the African culture. Buy a cane. Don't be afraid of flogging them. The Bible says, spare the rod, spoil the child. Look at what's going on in the U.S. The children are the ones controlling their parents. So I think we've done some work in how to measure failed marriage, right? I've shown you that. So let's see if we can pick another one. Let's look at how does God measure the failure of a husband? I've shown you how he measured the failure. So you already knowing, am I failing in my marriage? Divorce is not the ultimate proof of failure. Divorce is one of them, but I'm telling you now that look at, according to the Bible, there are things he looks and says, this marriage is not going the way it's supposed to go. He's looking at your children. Your children, the people that are under you, are indicators of whether or not that marriage is good. So let's deal with failure as a husband. How does God know a husband failed in that assignment? Let me tell you something you don't know about marriage. The reward of God to a man that works hard is not money. The reward of God to a man that serves him, first of all, is not wealth, not the material things. The reward of God for a man that works is a human being. The reward that God gives a man for toiling here, the first reward, the most important reward, is that person called your wife. And I'm not guessing. Ecclesiastes chapter 9 verse 9 tells us. He says to us, live happily with the woman you love through all the meaningless days of life. It was deliberate when he used the word meaningless. He said that God, he said, live happily with the woman you love through all the meaningless days of life that God has given you under the sun. The wife God gives you is what? is what? Your reward for all your earthly toil. So when you serve God, God rewards you with what? A wife. And how you treat that wife would determine whether you succeeded as a husband or you failed as a husband. Let's look at Proverbs 19 verse 14. He says, fathers can give their sons an inheritance of houses and wealth. But what happens? But only the Lord gives what? An understanding wife. If God gives you a wife that understands, that is your reward. And it comes from a place of toiling. Now, if you go back to Exodus chapter 9, the one we just read, verse 9 and 10, you see that the man was saying, whatever you do, if you read verse 10, he said, whatever you do, do it well. The reason he said it in verse 10 is because he's talking from verse 9. He said, whatever you do, do it well. From when you go to the grave, there'll be no work or planning or knowledge or wisdom. What he's telling you is that because God rewards you for your toiling with a woman, if you want a good wife, then do whatever you're doing well. Do it well. This is how God rewards an understanding wife. There are people that as you're laboring in life, God is raising your wife for you. He's putting her through training, putting her through processes so that she becomes a woman of understanding. And then they hand over that woman to you. And God say, this one is your wife. Have you noticed Adam? It was after he had toiled, God came and looked at him and said, ah, uncle, you have really toiled. You have taken care of the garden. Okay, you know what? It's time for reward. It is not good that you stay alone. That's when they now brought the woman. After he had walked, after he had toiled, they gave him an understanding wife. Hallelujah. So how you treat that particular woman determines whether you succeeded or you failed. Now let me tell you how you know you failed. 1 Peter 3:7. 1 Peter 3:7. So I want you to see your wife or the woman you want to marry, whatever it is you're doing, that woman is your reward. You need to enjoy that reward. That's why the Bible says the body of the woman does not belong to herself and the body of the man, vice versa. It's part of the reason. So now, the Bible tells us, 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 7, we're going to take a look at this. I'm going to show you how you know. Now you know this is your reward. How you know? Number one, how you treat your wife will determine whether you are a failed husband. You can't really see a failed husband by looking at the husband. You see a failed husband by looking at the wife. When your wife is not doing well, it is a failure on the part of the husband. When your wife is cantankerous, she's quarrelsome, she gossips, she fights, she's rude, she's not growing in knowledge, she's not growing in character, it's a reflection on you. It's a failed man, it's a failed husband. It's not the wife. One day I was telling pastor, I said, pastor, I went to preach somewhere, and the pastor was complaining. He said he goes to church 1 hour before service, and his wife always comes 1 hour after service, meaning that he comes to church 2 hours before the wife gets to church, because she comes 1 hour after service has started. His response was, what is he doing about it? It's not about you coming early. It's about the fact that your wife also comes early. It's a reflection on you. It's not the woman. That is why, even though it was Eve that started the drama of eat apple, don't eat apple, eat food, don't eat food, when God came, who did he ask first? He didn't talk to Eve. He first said, Uncle Adam, what happened? So men, you are going to answer questions on that wife that didn't turn out well. But let's read 1 Peter 3:7. I'm trying to run this quickly. He said, in the same way, you husbands, I've dealt with marriage, I'm dealing with husbands now. In the same way, you husband must do what? Give honor to your wives. Wives, say amen. Treat your wives with what? With what? You're not reading it well now, men. Treat your wives with what? Understand the woman. Your wife is not everybody. There are certain things she likes differently from other people. There are things, cultures also are different. Makes people different. However, beyond cultural differences, there are individual preferences. Cultural differences, if it's a birthday in all these white people, they'll buy you flower. In Nigeria, they will buy flower. Like when I travel abroad, they will now be one big giant flower and they spend money. In my mind, I'm saying, do these people think I'm in Europe? What's the meaning of that? I appreciate the flower, but okay, nice flower. We are not white people. But there are some women who they like it. Don't buy me flowers. What God said is, how you know you are a failed husband? You don't understand your wife's peculiarity, that this is her. This is what brings out the beauty. This is what makes your wife smile. Put a smile on that woman's face every morning. He said, as you live together, he said, she may be weaker than you are. He said, but she's your equal partner in God's gift of new life. He said, treat her as you should. Why? So that your prayers will not be hindered. This thing is so serious that it hinders the prayer of a lot of people. You are praying, speaking in tongues, shouting, screaming. God is not listening to you. Why? You have not treated the wife of your youth well. That woman is hurting. That woman doesn't like what you said or what you did. And vice versa. If the woman says, I don't like this, your friend, that ends the matter. There's no conversation. If there's any conversation, go and talk to God. If you feel this friend is my five and say, go and talk to God. God can appear to her and say, don't worry, it's calm. Don't worry, calm down about it. Whatever. But God has the heart of that your woman. So if your husband, the woman says, and you know that women, because they are giving, there's a way they are more perceptive than men. So even when they are not born again, they can pick signals 20 miles away. Instinct is there, just wired like that. They can pick it. They don't know why they are saying what they are saying, but they're just telling you. After some time, you see that exactly that thing they said, that's exactly correctly what's going on. It's a gift given to women. They have this thing in them. And then for the ones that pray, is more activated. Take advantage of the person that you have. Take advantage of that reward. There's a reason why God said that woman is a reward. She compliments you. Your strengths are her weaknesses. Your weaknesses are her strengths. You, man, you are not better. You, woman, you are not better. So he said, in the same way, treat them. So the way you treat that woman, if she's not well cared for, if she's not taken care of, some people, from the day they marry their wives, the woman began to degenerate. The woman was dressing well before. From the day you marry, the woman began to degenerate. The woman is not advancing spiritually. She's not advancing financially. She's not advancing in any area. She's just stagnant. Look, let me tell you, you're killing yourself. Do you know why? If that your wife does not advance, if anything happens to you, your children are in trouble. I don't know who your next of kin is, but if for any reason your next of kin is not your wife, from today as I'm talking to you, you leave this place, go and change it. There are many women that are suffering in penury today because the man did not go and make her the next of kin. Even if you hate the woman for the sake of your children, there's a case I dealt with. The man made his brother the next of kin. So all the things that were supposed to come to the wife went to the family, went to the man. Let your wife be the next of kin. You know, in African tradition and all over the world, when a man dies, the brothers, the family will try to take the property away. Which is why, put the name, put the land, the whatever, in your wife's name. And let the world know that you love your wife. And what your wife says counts. Because they'll find it hard to counter what, if she come and say, it's my husband's property. If you've been showing them that this woman means nothing, they will fight her when you are no more here. Some of your wives are not developed. See, there's no reason why you should be 10 steps ahead of your wife in any area, because it's both of you. So some of your wives, there's no business that woman is doing. If you are the only provider, because you want to shine. If anything happens to you as a person, if anything happens to that job, that whole family gets into trouble. So she's just there doing housewife, doing house laziness. I didn't miss church from the time I got pregnant for my first child till the last baby. Pregnancy was never a reason why I did not serve God. It was never a reason why I didn't do the things I needed to do. My third baby, I was on the poop. I knew I was due. I was on the poop. We're doing Heaven's Night. You know what Heaven's Night encounter program. I was praying for the sick when labor started. I felt it. I continued, finished all the ministration till the end, went and sat down. I didn't even leave. Went and sat. It was one usher that looked, because pastor was talking to me. I said, are you okay? I said, labor has started. He said, are you normal? I said, what do you want me to do? He said, are you not going to go? I said, service has not ended. I sat down there till they shared the grace. I went, gave birth that night, that day I gave birth. Next morning, I went home. By 12 noon, I said, discharge me, I'm fine. 3 weeks later, I was back in church. 3 weeks, 1 week, 2 weeks, three. It's tradition that says 3 months. I was back 3 weeks later. He will tell you, Debbie. So your wife is not strong. When my dad died, my dad was a military man. When he died, my uncles came and said, "Oh, our father's property. Who's father?" If my mom was not a strong woman, if she was not educated mentally, spiritually, they would have taken all our properties because we're a bit young at the time. So all the property, the lands and all of that, they would have taken everything from us. She was a strong woman. And my dad had told the whole world that is what my wife says. If you come and ask my dad anything, you say, "Wait, I'll talk to my wife. I don't care what you think." He's not negotiating. He said, "I will talk to my wife." So they'll be abusing. They'll say, "Your wife is controlling." He said, "If my wife doesn't control me, is it your wife that will control me?" He said, "The reason I married her so she will control me, do your worst." So everybody knew he was doing it on purpose. Because he knew when he dies, he knew what will happen. So when people came and said, "It's our father's property," even the Air Force people were like, "Who, this man?" When we got to the village to bury my father, the villager said they will not put him in the grave. My mom just looked at the Air Force people that came. She said, "Put him in the grave." We stood there. They by themselves, they began to dig the grave. Say, the villagers won't dig the grave because they were saying, "We'll show this woman that has put our husbands," whatever. The ministry men, they went, they dug the grave by themselves. They took him, they put him in the grave, put cement. They stood there all night till the cement dried. That's why in the military, let me tell you how they give rank in the military. Two people come. Let me show you, this is how they decorate military men when they are promoting them. A boy and a girl, so maybe one planting girl. See, let me tell you what happens. Your commanding officer, remember they give you decoration on two shoulders. You see them with decoration on two shoulders. You see them, correct? One on this side, one on this side. Your commanding officer will put one rank on your hand. Right? Your wife puts the second rank on your hand. The military, they understand something. So they know that this woman is not an idiot. This woman has to by herself give you that new rank. You are moving from captain to major. Your wife comes for the induction, for the ceremony. Your commanding officer puts it, they pin it. Next thing they say, "Madam, pin on him." That's what they do. Please sit. Number two, let's look at it that way. How your wife, think I've dealt with that. How your wife turns out spiritually. So if we're here in the church, your wife gossip, your wife stole, your wife did this, you, the man, should hide yourself in shame. Because the Bible says in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 25, he said, "For husband, this means love your wives just as Christ loved the church." Right, I'm reading Ephesians 5:25. "He gave up his life for her, live sacrificially." My husband gives me the best. If there are two things, he will give me the best. And I'm not saying it because I'm supposed to say it is true. If I'm lying, then there are many people that come to my house. My children are here. He said, "To make her holy and clean, washed by the cleansing of God's word." So this is the job that God does, Jesus does for the church. It is the job the husband does for the wife. You make that wife pure. You make her holy. Some of you, there is no training. There is no investment in that woman you call your wife. No investment. You don't sit with her. You don't correct her. This thing you are doing is not proper. This thing you are doing is wrong. When that woman fails, it's you. If she fails spiritually, it's you. If she fails financially, it's you. Empower your wives. Imagine if it's only Pastor Ronnie alone. He would have died by now because he will preach all the whole locations. He will preach. He will do every single thing by himself. Because I'm too weak and too incapacitated, both spiritually, both mentally, both educationally, both in every area. The Bible says two. Let me tell you what marriage and fatherhood is. It is a plane that has two wings. When one of the, that has two engines, when one engine goes down, the other one kicks in. Many times planes are flying, one engine fails in the air. What happens? The second engine had the capacity to carry the plane until it lands. So many times, the moment a man, something goes wrong with the man, that whole family is destroyed. The woman becomes a poor, wretched widow because of failure of the husband. Make your wife feel special. Make her feel that she's the most special person in the whole world. Make her feel loved. Treat her well. Let her know. Let her understand. Find out about her. Don't worry. When is women convention? People come and tell us, "Women, submit to your husband." We will answer you people. But I'm telling you what to do so that you please God. Should I go on? Failure as a father. Let me run through. I'm a professional and we'll end it here in a few minutes. So let's deal with professional, even though I still have a lot to say.
failure as a father, Ephesians chapter 6, verse 5. I think we've dealt with it. You are the one to nurture your children. So when your children are not raised well, it is not the fault of the woman. Because you know what they normally say? When a child gets it right, whose child is it? The father. When a child fails, whose child is it? They'll say, it's the mother. Your mother is useless. But let it be that the child came first in the class. Hey, my son, my daughter. But see what the Bible says. He said, provoke not your children to anger by the way you treat them. So the same way you are treating your wife well, treat your children well. Let them feel special. Let them know their father loves them. The same way you know that God loves you. Let me tell you, it will be hard for you to understand the love of God if you don't understand the love of a father. My dad, I was someone that was loved by my dad and thankfully loved by my husband. So I don't have those kind of issues. But there are a lot of women that are shadows of themselves. They are unemployed. They can't speak. They are slow. Their mind is not functioning well. Not because there's anything physically wrong or psychologically wrong, but because they didn't understand the love of a father. They also don't, when they now marry, they don't have love of a husband. Then when they are now in church, they don't have love of the brothers. You brothers. And I used to tell women, don't do heavy duty things. Let the men do the heavy lifting. Me, you see ball? Me, climb, change ball. I will stay in that darkness. Not because I don't know how to change a ball, but because women are not meant to do. I used to see some people, when they want to carry communion tape, they are men, no? You see? And tomorrow you're looking for us, and I wonder why you're not married. You're a babe. You're a sweet darling. You're a pretty girl. You should be taken care of. We are the ones that need the soft life. Come on, ladies. High five, girls. We need the soft life. I don't carry anything. My husband, he'll be the one. He will carry the whatever. If you like, say he's spoiling me. It's okay. He's not spoiling you. It's not his wife. If he spoils his wife, who will suffer? It's him. So let him, please. If he's okay, you say, I've told you, don't carry anything. He will carry it. If there are two pillows, one is bad, one is good, you give me the good one. He said, no, don't do it. Carry the suitcase, he'll be the one to carry. Every heavy lifting. Bob spoiled. Oh, really? I mean, why are you in darkness? Oh, the bulb spoiled. Yeah. You people, he will not. He will climb. He will fix it. If the car spoils on 10 minutes, what do you think I will do? I will now become a man, open bonnet, and I'll be checking time. He doesn't know this, but I know how to do all those things. He thinks I'm weak and incapacitated. Even my children, they think I'm weak. So they're always available. Oh God, does she? Mommy is alone. Does she? Do you need anything? Are you sure? Are you okay? Me that I'm stronger than all of them combined, put together. Car spoil me road. Ha. Honey, so I'm on one street. I think it's Lawson. Yeah. So I'm in an Uber going home, but the car is like on Third Mainland Bridge and that's spoiled. So where are you? I'm on my way to where I'm going to. So what about the key? Okay, so how do I send you the key? That's how the car will be fixed is his problem. How the car will come back home is what? His problem. But while I'm doing it, I'm also conscious of what to do because there might be a time when I'll need to do it. But as long as there is a man, you step back, allow him do the man thing. Some of us are women, but we are men. But we are learning to be women. Is that okay? So be a babe. Eh? Don't be calling your husband babe. He'll be a baby and childish. It's the man that should call you babe. I don't understand why they call men babe. So a whole John, Pastor John. You just understand. Help me. Eh? A whole lawyer that went to law school, graduated, spitting fire as a man of God. They would finish him and say, babe, how? Eh? Pastor also, because can judge Kennedy's case. A whole man of God, a whole man of God. Eh? A whole man of God. Eh? They have called you a babe. Why? No. Let me tell you the person that is a babe. Eh? See her, babe Moji. Give us a high five. Give us a wave. She's a babe. Soft life. Soft life. Where are the babes in the house? I say, Mama, woo! And it's not loud. No, please. Can I hear the babes in the house, please? Hey.
And when you're saying bye-bye, it's not bye-bye. No. Ciao. That's how you do it. See, let me tell you. Don't be opening car door. Let them open door for you. Let them open door for you. It's not this one. After 2 days of marriage, they will not open door. Let them open door. What do they mean? When they were marrying you, what did they? Let them open door. You too, give them reason to open door. Some of you, your nightwear, women. Hey, Holy Ghost fire should burn your nightwear. They should burn your nightwear. Some of you, in this 21st century, you are still tying, how do you say it in Igbo? Ma kwa ne obi, she? In this 21st century, and you want them to treat you like a babe. No, they can't. You to dress well. Put your hair in order. Wear things that match. Understand clothing. Understand all of those systems. So that your husband will treat you well. Is that okay? Mercy, you get the point. Man, give me a high five, Jerry. A baby high five. Yeah. That's, dress well. Look okay. Look sweet. Not early in the morning. Look at how you are. Early in the morning, your excuse is that it's morning, so you can dress anyhow. No, you can't find a hair out of place. Even if it's at 3 a.m. in the morning, look good. Don't go to your husband's bed smelling. Have your bath, brush your teeth. There are perfumes for evening. You wear your nightwear and you lie down. Hallelujah. All right, let me take one more as a professional. Is that okay? And we end it. How does God measure failure as a Christian professional? Well, number one, when you are not using your giftings to advance the kingdom of God. When you're not using that particular organization to advance the kingdom of God. So question, in this profession, I'm a doctor, I'm a lawyer, whatever it is that I am, how has it impacted on the kingdom, both in terms of the finance that is coming from there, both in terms of the skills? So there are many of you, you have skills, but it's only for the secular world, it's only for Caesar. Is the kingdom of God benefiting from the skills and the talents that you have? Some of you, you know how it is in the organization. You're doing well. You're the A person in the organization. But you come into the church and you sit at the back. So God is not benefiting from that, those skills and all of that. So what it means that as a professional, according to God's scorecard, you failed. You're a failed Christian professional. Look at what he told the people with the talent. He said, you hid your talent in the ground. The thing is so serious that God said, you're going to outer darkness. Hallelujah. So that's how you look at your, that's your scorecard for the Christian professional. I think you've been able to have an idea of how God scores. So what a wise person will do from now on is to go and sit down as a man and say, okay, what is my scorecard? God will score you, but I want you to go and talk to your wife. How am I doing as a husband? Talk to God. How am I doing as a Christian? How am I doing? Because God has what he's going to tell you. But the woman that you are treating well is what I'm going to tell you. This is good. I like that you do this. I like that you do that. I would prefer if you do it this way. I prefer to do it that way. That way you improve on what you're doing. Don't just tell your husband. Don't just tell your wife, I love you. That one is compulsory. Tell your wives, I like you. You understand? So he doesn't just say, I love you. He says, I like you as a person. You are likable. You delight me. You please me. I hear what I'm saying. So do it today. Women, if they don't tell you that, tell me. Amen. Open the door for them. Hallelujah. So this is it. This is how you do men's scorecard, as much as I could cover. So I want us to just bow our heads and talk to the Father. Where you have missed it, say, Lord, I honestly am sorry. Forgive me and help me. There's a person called the Holy Spirit. That your marriage must not fail. As a Christian, you can't fail. As a Christian professional, you can't fail. Tell God, I can't. Help me, Holy Spirit, help me. Marriage is done by the help of the Spirit of God. Ministry is done by the help of God. Ask God, help me. I don't want to fail you, Lord. When I'm weighed in the balance, I don't want to fail. Trust God and pray.